Have you ever wondered who was the strongest man in ancient Greece? Well, let's find out. Well, it turns out I'm not the strongest man alive, but I decided to give it a try, and I still got bruises on my shoulder from doing so. But without any further ado, let's dive into our topic. Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to my channel, Greek Fit, where we discuss everything related with exercise, nutrition, and philosophy. This video is dedicated to possibly one of the strongest men in ancient Greece, if not the strongest. This is all based in a finding that we have in the Museum of Olympia in Greece, and this finding is a huge stone weighing 134.5 kilos, which is approximately 316 libras, and this huge stone has a writing on it. Now this writing says, quote, "Hereby Bybon lifted me above his head with one arm." That's right. So we have this writing saying that a man in ancient Greece lifted a stone which was 135 kilos above his head with one arm. And today's video is all about discussing if this is possible and what are the differences to today. Before we dive into the differences, let's take a look at what the world record is right now for this specific action. And if I'm not mistaken, it's done in 2017, and it's 314 kilos, so half a kilo less than Bybon back then. But this is not the exciting thing, because as we're diving into the differences, you will come to find that it's actually more admirable than this half a kilo difference between the now and the back then. So the first difference between now and back then, I would say, is that back then they didn't have specific gear, they didn't have all this technology that we are implementing into training, into nutrition, into everything. I would go as far as saying that there is some gear and technology involved in the actual competing as well, such as belts, different shoes, different outwear, or knee sleeves, elbow sleeves. They might have had something, but I mean for sure it wasn't up to our technology right now, and it wouldn't be as much studied and as much helpful in my opinion. This has also to do with training, with periodic training, with nutrition, with all this knowledge that is available to us right now, and we would only assume that back then they didn't have this knowledge. But, as it seems, maybe they had not so much knowledge about different things. The few things that they saw, they understood maybe better than us. So maybe this is some food for thought. If you agree with me, feel free to comment down below, agreed. Diving on to the second difference. Now, the difference between dumbbell raising and stone raising. You can find this difference even nowadays. There are powerlifting or weightlifting competitions And then you have the strongman competition. People, athletes go and compete against each other, and this is done, the measurement is done of how much they can lift through specific barbells, dumbbells, whatever. There are different types of it, different categories depending on how much your body weight is. And then you have the strongman, which is also classified with how much your weight is, but the difference is that you're lifting more natural, so to say, obstacles. So you're trying to lift stones and put them up somewhere. You're lifting different things that are not so common in weightlifting. You don't see them in gyms, and they're closer to what you would lift if you were out in nature and you found, let's say, a log of a tree or a big bag of sand or iron or something like that, or a stone in our case. It's unfair to compare lifting a stone, which by the way had a specific specifically carved handle inside so that he can put his hand in, but nevertheless it's not fair to compare it with a dumbbell. A dumbbell is basically a piece of metal that you hold and has evenly distributed the same weight on one side and the other of the hand. A stone you cannot control. You don't know how the weight is dispersed among the whole stone, how it's distributed. So I would say that lifting a stone is much, much harder. Now, the third difference we have now with them back then is more of a taboo subject, but I will go into it regardless, and it's performance enhancing drugs, PEDs. So, different drugs have come up in the fitness industry, such as they did in every industry, and these drugs are to increase your performance. There are many different kinds of them. I'm not so much familiar, but there are a bunch of them that you can take for various reasons and at different stages of your training. What I want you to consider is that steroids, so to say, enhancing drugs, became adopted around 1980, I think. They were invented way before, but they were mostly adopted in the 1980s and afterwards. So before the 1980s, we would see in competitions and so on much smaller bodies, still defined, still looked strong, most of them really competitive. But then in 1980s and afterwards, there was a huge eruption in the physiques of competitors, in athletes, and so on and so forth. So why is this so important? Anyone that has read about what all these things do to performance and to your physique knows this is huge. This is like comparing someone who is driving a Ferrari with someone that is trying to build his own Ferrari. It's totally different. So, getting these things, you have a huge advantage over your competition. I'm not underestimating the work done in nutrition, in workouts, exercise, or whatever. You still gotta work out, you still have to do some things to be successful, but still, back then, I don't believe they had things like that. They sure put emphasis on many herbs, many foods. They had a whole ideology behind them, which goes where, when to eat what, but it was much more simplistic. And their whole ideology was much different than what we have right now. So to conclude, performance enhancing drugs were not available back then, which clearly makes it more than obvious that it's much more interesting. So that's it for today, guys. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, please hit the like button. If you want to see more videos coming soon, please hit the subscribe button. And of course, for any comments that you have and any questions, any suggestions, please feel free to comment down below on what you would like to see next or any questions that you might have. Thank you.